Version 7.0 of Switcher Studio is now live, and this is its user interface along with all the features that you need to know. Okay, so we're in the Switcher Studio interface then. As soon as you log in, this is exactly what you will see. You've got various different icons on the bottom right hand side, and you've also got different spaces on the screen as well. On the top right hand side, you've got all your different sources. Those could be cameras, those could be assets such as lower thirds, titles, overlays, images, and movies. You name it, it's all in there. At the bottom left hand side, you've got various view options. Tapping on the left hand view gives you a preview of your stream before it then goes live to the window on the right hand side. Deselecting that then, the next one along gives you different options for groups and also the size of the images that you'll see on the left hand side. If you haven't got very many sources, then you can change the size of these to fill in the real estate of the screen. And if you've got lots, and obviously you can reduce that to the smallest size. So underneath we've got edit groups, and what you can do is you can edit the production groups that those assets belong in. So we'll talk a bit more about that later on, but production groups is a really good aspect and a good feature of version 7.0. To add in a source then, as ever, you tap the blue plus button at the bottom. Most of these assets options are very, very similar to the last time in 5.6. But if we tap on cards are really useful because you can, as you're going live, you can have a preview of yourself. So you, for example, can have camera in the background, and you can have lots of different overlays going over your live image with no sound. So it's quite a nice way of engaging the audience before they come in. Images background, if you wanted a static image with some other overlays, such as your logo or some other titles such as who's going to be speaking or what to expect. You've got two views, two movies that you can have before your stream goes live. You can scroll and you can see different picture-in-picture options there. And finally, live selling samples. So this is all about Switcher Studio's drive for live selling, which is a really big feature in their app coming forward in this year 2022 going forward. So you can see that live selling examples really is kind of demos of the examples which I've just shown you before. So if you are selling a product or service, this is a really useful way to be able to do that. And one of the really useful feature at the very bottom is if you want to have a countdown timer before you go live, you can then use this and then edit it as well. So for example, if you wanted a minute timer, you could then do that. You could then drag the minute timer around the screen, resize it, and of course you can then change its orientation, both vertical and horizontal. You can add different layers, whether you want this to be a full screen layer or an overlay. And then of course the transition time for going to and from other transitions, so another source. And of course the type of thumbnail, and if you want, audio. So if, for example, you want people to hear you before you go live, you would then select that, deselect that if you don't want them to hear you. And then of course, as usual, very similar to what's gone before, apply on preview, stay on top, which means that nothing else would override it, and then you choose your production group. The other new aspect of this is some of the Switcher Cloud options, as well as some of the text and graphic options. So if we go to Multiviews, those have pretty much stayed the same. There are now options for six or more. Very, very full-on and complicated multi-views that you can have there. And of course, you can then go into Switcher Cloud, which allows you to share assets from your Switcher Studio account, and it will then auto-populate here as well. Input is very much similar as it was before. Nothing much has changed here in version 7. So we're going to move on to the bottom right-hand side icons. Now yours may be in a different order to what's on the screen here. I'll show you how you can change the order, but on the order I've got here, we're starting with the camera controls. When you load up a camera, you'll of course add it as a source via the blue button, and you'll use input, and it will then allow you to use one of these cameras here. So for example, if I wanted to add this phone, then what I could do is I could have a top-down view at the moment and you can see what I'm doing at the moment. To access those camera controls, you must have an input sorted out, and in this case I've got focus, exposure, white balance. All these options were available in the previous video and the previous iterations of the app. They're fairly self-explanatory, and if you want any questions answered about these, pop them in below. Next we've got inputs then. Inputs, as we've just briefly touched on, are all the different cameras that you can then input into your production. I've got four here. I've got a display that we can use. I've also got a phone, which I would use for my face, and also I've got my iPad as well, which I'm also running as a screen share source into the one that's recording the actual production as well. Next along then is the outputs then. You've got Facebook, YouTube, LinkedIn Live, Twitch, custom RTMP, and a brand new option for version 7, which is the multi-streaming. Now, I've gone into a bit more depth about multi-streaming in a different video. Again, I'll link this below and also in the top right hand side. But if we just tap on multi-streaming, what it does is it allows you to connect to more than one output. So for example, if you wanted to stream live on Twitch, if you're a gamer, but also YouTube at the same time, you can create in Facebook, YouTube, as well as RTMP. Now, if you cross post to Facebook pages, this does not go against your limit. At the moment, you can limit two places at once. So I could stream to Facebook and YouTube, or Facebook and an RTMP source. So that would probably allow you to do other options there. So you can stream to two or more places, wherever you want. And of course, I've shown you how to do that in the other video on my channel. So multi-streaming is a really good new facet there. In terms of the transitions, nothing much has changed. They're very much the same as they were in the previous version. And then as you can see here in the audio section, you've got the monitored audio, which from this screen shared iPad is in built-in microphone. So it's picking up my voice via the microphone. But on the actual production iPad I'm using to record this tutorial, it's basically on the iPad through the audio interface. And as you go further down, you can see voice mode and audio monitoring. Audio monitoring is basically if you wanted to hear what you sounded like. So for example, you plug in a set of headphones and hear your voice to check that the audio was okay. But through director mode and also through an audio interface, this mode should be turned off, otherwise you will get echo. The auto switch allows you to shuffle between different cameras automatically, and then what happens is you can then change the order that they go in. So you can either have it in standard order or a random order, and then you can change the interval that you can go between those. I usually set it to 3 seconds. It's more than enough time to keep people engaged. It gives that nice dynamicism to your videos. And then comments. Even though you are multi-streaming, you can see here it's connected to Facebook and YouTube. So it means that you'll be able to draw comments from both of the sources that you set up in your multi-stream, which is really handy. And of course, whenever you see a comment you want to feature on the screen, you just tap that comment and there it appears right on your stream. So we've got remote guest as well. Remote guest is really good. Again, it says here it does not work in director mode. Now remember, director mode allows you to take a high quality recording from all of your devices, aggregates it into one edited live stream as it was when you put out your live stream. And of course, if you want to be able to use a remote guest, then you would want to switch this off. You can then have different options for muting your guests, hosting from this device, or forcing voice mode. And as you can see at the moment, those are enabled by default, but you can then have a look at those if you want to be able to do that, because it all depends on what audio source your guests have as well. Very much similarly to what had happened before, Scoreboard has pretty much remained the same. That's a really nice feature as well. And if you have no idea what order these icons are in, you've also got the customization option, which allows you to move the inputs and the outputs and the effects and all of the different customized options into the order that you want. So what you could do is if you wanted the inputs to appear first, you would do that, close this window, scroll all the way along to the left, and there you've got your inputs is the first option there as well. So I'll be going into a lot more detail about the app and its uses. So if you're a musician, if you're a gamer, if you're a business person, I'm going to be showing you how you can utilize this app for the best mobile live stream production that you have ever experienced as well. There's lots of extra applications that you'll be able to use. So make sure that you hit like on this video as well as tap the bell notification so that you don't miss any future videos. Thank you very much for watching, and of course, any questions you've got, ask them down below. I'll see you in the next one.